Macmillan Audio presents Desert Oracle, Volume 1, Strange True Tales from the American Southwest, by Ken Layne, narrated by Ken Layne. Dedication. For the good people who love and protect the desert wilderness. Introduction. Within these pages are many mysteries of the desert. Some are cruel and terrible, others sublime, and a persistent few remain inexplicable by our current metrics of understanding. Desert is wilderness stripped bare, and when left alone is creation and perfection. The landscape is vast and visible, the geology raw and exposed, the plants and animals in ideal proportion. Fresh water is generally in limited supply, but that has never stopped life from thriving in lands of little rain. Our own species has always been fond of these harsh and arid places. The first civilizations rose up from the desert sands. Mesopotamia, ancient Egypt, the Indus Valley. The wilderness of antiquity was wild desert, and that's where our philosophers and prophets went to meditate on mountaintops, to abandon society for a while and sleep under the stars or within limestone caves. There were many river valley civilizations in the North American desert, too, before our current mess of outlet malls and cell towers and interstates. The Hohokam in the Salt River Valley, beneath modern Phoenix. The ancient Pueblo culture of the Four Corners. The Taos Pueblo is a rare unbroken link to those varied pasts. Despite the plastic letters on the gas stations and the same banal television programming beamed or streamed into every home, Taos is more or less as it was when Hernando de Alvarado arrived some 5 centuries ago, and as it had been centuries earlier when the Roman Church was still struggling to Christianize the diverse peoples of Europe. Through a combination of accident and intent, much of the American desert remains mostly intact, mostly wild. The accident was in the claiming of so much American territory by the U.S. federal government in the mid-1800s. Actions taken to prevent competing claims and occupation by Spain, Mexico, France, England, Russia, all of our old imperial rivals. Places with surface water attracted settlers, despite the heat and the sandstorms and scorpions, while the vast walls of mountains and expanses of dry lakes and valleys were spared much permanent development. This was followed by dramatic efforts to preserve and protect these desert ecosystems as national parks and monuments, and federally designated wilderness, actions inspired by the nature mystics of American transcendentalism. In the 21st century, conservationists aim to save what they can of entire ecosystems, and not just photogenic islands of flora and fauna surrounded by industrial mining and eroded cattle range. Even without the dense forests we associate with the crucial storage of carbon on this planet, wild desert forms an immense carbon sink over a third of our planet's landmass. From the ancient aquifers beneath the parched surface to the vast networks of microbiotic crusts that bind the desert together. This is a simplified explanation to a complex question. Why is so much of the American desert held in public trust? And is not intended to negate the intentional horrors visited upon indigenous cultures, the wide-scale extermination of desert species, or the determined efforts today by humanity-hating fanatics to reverse our limited protections of this earthly paradise. When you are in the great desert wilderness, you must carry some understanding of why it's still that way. Why is so contrary to the numbing sprawl of our current civilization? Is the way it is because people spent lifetimes fighting to keep it that way, suffering more defeats than victories because when you love a place, that is what you do. If this landscape affects your soul in this manner, you may have no choice but to join the noble and holy effort. We could use your help. Whether you become a park ranger or join the Green New Deal Conservation Corps or volunteer a couple of times per year to clean up a nature preserve or lead school kids on backcountry hiking trips. You might even need to become an outlaw, a hero. We are not so far away from the old times of adventure, of great deeds. Do not fall into the trap of anxiety and emptiness. There is purpose waiting out here for anyone who comes in honest pursuit of it. A revelation in the desert is available in our time. It may fit a practice or theology you bring along with your water and walking stick and beer cans and yoga mat, or it may shatter your psyche entirely. Both are worth the effort, worth the trouble, worth going where a few others travel, worth leaving behind the dull comforts of tourist resorts and constant connection. Some people see the face of God, whoever she is, blasting light beams into their brains on the desert highway. Some people fall off a boulder and spend days wondering if they'll live or die. There's always one or the other. I have witnessed pure wild joy on a fellow human's face simply because there was no telephone signal available, no electronic map display to show the nearest cluster of coffee and hamburger chains. Freedom, finally. Out here, beyond the robotic grip of a civilization in disarray and despair, I promise you will feel human again, if only for a little while. Should this experience of old wonder appeal to you, then you will be back as often as possible, and you may have no choice but to call the desert home. And if it's home, you have no choice but to defend it. There's nothing more fun than a purpose in life. Try not to die. It wasn't supposed to go like this, wasn't the plan at all. The plan was to get out of town for a few days and explore the desert. Fill up the Instagram feed with abandoned gas stations and cracked asphalt, two lanes snaking through forests of Joshua trees. Beers at a roadhouse, impulse buys at a boutique on Highway 62, a night under the stars from the safety of an Airbnb hot tub or a campfire ring. And now it's a late summer day, well over 100 degrees, not a stylish swimming pool or outdoor cocktail bar in sight. You've been sitting in the car, the doors flung open, the burning air wrapped around you, suffocating and dense and so very dry. An empty cardboard coffee cup in the drink holder. An empty plastic water bottle crumpled under the seat. It is midday, which means in 7 or 8 hours, the ball of orange fire in the sky will finally sink behind the mountains and the temperature will sink down to 95 degrees or so if you're lucky. Something gave out. The gas in the tank or the city tires or the transmission or maybe the rear axle. Snapped in two by a boulder partially buried in the sand on this godforsaken dirt road you never meant to be on, never consciously chose to take at all. The voice of the navigation robot was as sure as ever. Turn right at the gas station. Even though there was little left of that particular gas station, and the road itself was forlorn and untroubled by recent tire tracks. There was something you were headed for, an art exhibit on the open desert, a historic mining site, a location from a television show you remembered, a sweeping view of the National Monument. It doesn't matter now. Unless you write it down, Nobody will ever know why you wound up dead on a rough sandy track that could charitably be called a jeep trail. Even if they find your remains, which might not happen for years, your personal story will not be told. Maybe there will be a local news article somewhere, human remains found hours from nearest settlement, that kind of thing. If anybody remembers you, maybe they'll clip it out of the newspaper, bookmark the website page. You had so much life left to live, so many things you never got around to doing. And now all you're going to do is become a sunbaked skeleton picked over by vultures and ants. One bony hand stretched out ahead. Maybe at the end, you thought you were almost home. The Mojave Desert covers much of Southern California and a bit of the neighboring states, Southern Nevada, the Arizona Strip, the bottom corner of Utah. Before this dried-out expanse of burnt chocolate mountains and blinding playas and lonely roads became beautiful in the eyes of the beautiful people, it was something to endure on the way to Las Vegas or the Colorado River, or something to survive on the way to whatever was luring you to the West Coast. There were always desert rats, always the antisocial sort who looked at this punishing landscape and felt at home. The romantics, the people who required a weird backdrop to fit their personal movie. But there were never enough of them to fill many hotel rooms or vacation rentals. And so the desert was mostly ignored unless the steady jobs of the Los Angeles basin were in commuting distance. Unless a corporation gets a hold of some government desert land to use for giant solar towers or windmills or a gold mine, or some insane scheme to pump the groundwater from the Mojave to Orange County, the desert interior consists of unfenced national parks and national monuments, with no authorized entry military bases and massive blocks of nearly untouched wilderness filling the map between the Sierra Nevada, Las Vegas, and the urban sprawl of Southern California. Luckily for those who love this wild desert and its natural state, over the past 100 years, a few visionaries were able to set aside much of this landscape as an immense desert preserve that rivals anything on Earth in size. Only the vast Namibian Desert Preserve on the southwestern edge of the African continent is larger than the 10 million protected acres of the Great Mojave Wilderness, from the tip of Death Valley National Park to San Gorgonio, within the new Sand to Snow National Monument. Most Mojave visitors stay close to Joshua Tree National Park, and especially to its well-traveled sightseeing spots and tourist traps. If you get a flat tire or a dead battery on the Park Boulevard loop between 29 Palms and the unincorporated village of Joshua Tree, a friendly ranger will come along before long. And if your Airbnb turns out to be a lightly redecorated meth shack without a working toilet, you can always drive to a motel. Get lost on a remote trail or break down off the highway and you're going to have a very different experience. Maybe you'll survive and maybe you'll become part of our rich history of lost tourists. We add a few names to this roster every summer, if the names are known anyway. Maybe you're not ready to be on this list of people the Mojave chewed up and spit out. Maybe you have plans, plans that require coming home without the aid of a black vinyl body bag. The good news is that the gospel of desert survival is short, simple, and easy to remember. 1. Water and lots of it. Maybe you can dig up some sandy, alkaline water from the damp edge of a wash if you're lucky enough to be there just after a good soaking, which is unlikely. Maybe you can build a solar still if you happen to drive around with science project supplies. Or maybe you can bash open a barrel cactus, but it's best to leave that to the bighorn sheep, who don't get sick from the bitter mush within. Why not just carry plenty of water and not worry about your Eagle Scout technique? When you're at the grocery store buying whiskey and marshmallows for the campfire, fill up the extra space in the shopping cart with cheap plastic jugs of water. $10 worth of gallon jug water in the trunk can significantly raise the odds of surviving your Mojave ordeal. Please recycle the plastic jugs once you're rescued. 2. Don't waste that phone charge. Of course, you've got a car charger for your phone. Before a day hike or a backcountry adventure, make sure that thing is charged up and don't run it down looking at Instagram or whatever. You're already in the scenic desert. While there are plenty of remote spots without any cell coverage, in much of the Mojave you can get a cell signal.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.